Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord, look upon the verses, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. We ask you, Lord, look upon the heads of the countries everywhere, Lord. Kings and queens, Lord Jesus, presidents, Lord. In the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord, to look upon their minds, their hearts, and their souls, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. Give them to know, Lord God of hosts, Lord, that you are in charge, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. We ask you, Lord Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord, to look upon, Lord Jesus, the hopeless everywhere, Lord. In the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord, to look upon, Lord Jesus, those, Lord, that straining, Lord Jesus, to find a place, Lord Jesus, that is safe and sound, Lord Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord, that they may raise their children, Lord, in the name of Jesus, safe situation, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord, to look upon the countries, Lord, that are in wars and rumors of wars, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord, we ask you, Lord Jesus, to look upon each and every sanctuary throughout the nation, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to look upon the prophets, Lord Jesus, in the name of Jesus, the apostles, Lord, in the name of Jesus, missionaries, Lord, pastors, Lord, in your name, Lord Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. We ask you, Lord, take charge of your service today, Lord, and have your way, Lord Jesus. We ask you, Lord Jesus, to look upon the speaker and the teacher today, Lord. Anoint, Lord Jesus, with your word, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. We thank you right now, Lord Jesus, for your presence, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. Look upon the young and old, behind prison bars, Lord, and juvenile hall, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. Touch their mind, body, hearts, and souls, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. We ask you, Lord Jesus, to move in a mighty way, Lord, according to your will, your way, and your grace, Lord, in the name of Jesus, like God of hosts, Lord. We ask you, Lord Jesus, bless and anoint the speaker for the day, Lord. These blessings and others we ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. This time we'll turn you over to the praise team. Let us receive a better word from amen.
Amen. Amen. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Welcome to the house of the Lord. Who's happy to be in the house of the Lord today?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
Amen. God is so good.
All the time. Amen. All the time.
Turn on to Brother Kevin.
How we always open.
Get ready to praise God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
We have no excuse.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
I will praise. We extol you from generation to generation. You are worthy. Hallelujah.
Yeah. Yeah. Bless the Lord, my soul.
Run and not grow.
and you need to know, I have so many minister friends of mine that I got to kind of back away from them because they don't understand that there's only two people in this world. There's only two kind of people. The saved and the lost. There's a lot of lost Republicans out there. There's a lot of lost Democrats out there. But the point is that they're lost. And they have confused salvation with politics. And Jesus said, ye must be born again. You must repent. You must. It's not a maybe. You must. It is a condition that we must do. Because we have to be conditioned in Christ Jesus. We have to put on the renewing of our minds every day. We got to be conditioned to this world. Because if you're not conditioned against this world, this world will become against you. I said some things on Facebook and I got some really nasty, foul people back to me. Who claim to be Christians using all sorts of words that I never heard in Christian churches. And I said, I don't know what church you go to. But the God I believe in, His word, His word is true and cannot lie. And it's the same yesterday, today, forever. Forever means to you, but forever means to me forever. Forever. Never coming back. Forever. But there's church teachings in church today that forever is only a little bit.
Yes.
I see they don't understand what the Alpha and Omega means. Somebody's not talking to mind. Amen. Somebody that did not potty train them in Christ. They're still chewing on the Bible. My little granddaughter, you know, she's 11 months and she's getting her teeth in. So we gave her a book, you know, put her in the backseat, you know, and strapped her in, gave her a book. I get out and she's chewing on that book. To a place that the cover is not there hardly anymore. And I see a lot of Christians doing the same thing with the Word of God. They're chewing the cover off it. Not understanding it. But as we grow in Christ, as we grow in His wisdom, His mercy, and His love, you know what? There's something about Jesus. There's something about His word. There's just something about that name.
Hallelujah.
There's just something about it that no other name was given among men where we can have salvation.
Amen.
None other. I just got to preach to brothers. I'm sorry. Preaching to you. Maybe that I've been, God has blessed me and really been taking care of me. And I just want to come here and say that, you know, we're all Christians. We're all Christ-like. We're all in the same body of Christ.
Praise
Amen.
Lord.
No matter what, my wife had to work today. They called her in. She actually now is the manager of the meat department. And every once in a while, she has to work on a Sunday. Of course, she gets $3 more an hour. Which, hallelujah to that.
Yes, hallelujah.
So I don't complain too much. But it's always nice to have her. Amen. But we've been married a long time. But you know, God's grace is a powerful thing that we can have in our family. And we live in His power and His grace, then we'll see God doing some really wonderful things in our lives. Amen. And never give up on your children. I haven't given up mine yet. Amen. I'm not happy with some of them.
Right.
That don't mean I don't love them.
That's right.
And I know sometimes God's not always happy with you. But He doesn't mean that He doesn't love you. I know that's true. I was one ornery guy in my younger days. But God still loved me. And God still cared for me. And now I'm 62. I didn't think I was making 62, brother. I didn't think we were going to make it 2020, but I guess we're going to.
Alright.
I'm praying that God comes. It's getting crazy out there. I can't wait till that day Christ comes and then Christ arrives. And I hope I'm doing somebody's funeral. Who loves the Lord, when Jesus comes, and He jumps out of that coffin and says, I'm on my way, right behind you. And I told one of my friends don't believe in the rapture. I said, well, it's okay, you stay. Come walk with me. You want to stay? Go ahead, stay. But you know, the children of Israel were left out of the promised land because of what? Unbelief. Amen? I believe that all the promises of God are mine. Every blessing in the Bible is mine, and I am going to claim it in Jesus' name. Because that's what he said to do, isn't it? Amen? Said to. So if Jesus said it, I believe it, because the word cannot lie. That's all I'm going to say to you here.
It'll be in the back. In the back room. All right, we get the back room. Amen. Yay. Favor and honor, amen. We'll see if we like them. All right. And GoFundMe link. It's in your bulletins. We're going to have it in there every week. That is for the Peru schools. Okay. They started with one school, it was K through 12. They have started 128 churches from their graduates over the last, how many years has it been, Barbara?
It's been 1999.
Okay, since 99, so 19 years. In 19 years, they've started 128 churches. They started with 15 students. Ray and Barbara did this as unto the Lord. They have never received a penny for doing this missionary work. They've just done what God told them to do. Amen. And God has blessed them mightily. Yes, Noah.
What's the price of the crab feed?
Crab feed price? $45.
Is it just crab?
I'm sorry?
It's crab.
In Triton, right?
Yes. I'll get you a flyer.
Yeah.
Okay. What are the
flyers
here today?
You
know, we have flyers.
Yeah, we'll get flyers out. Okay. As we get closer to that March.
We have them.
Okay, we have them. All right. So, but back to Peru. The link is in here. Okay. Share it with your friends, family, enemies. I don't care. Anybody you know. If you're in contact with, share it. You never know who's going to be, you know, who the Lord will put on their heart to add some money to that GoFundMe account. Amen? You never know who God will tell to, you know, we could get a millionaire out there somewhere. Amen? You know, start praying for it.
Yeah.
Right? So share it with everybody. Okay, get on Facebook. I put it in Victory Tabernacle's page. So you can get it off there and just share it from there. All right, as well as my own. Yes, Kevin?
It's also on the website, and I also posted it on the YouTube channel, too.
Okay, so we can also find it on the YouTube channel that we have, Victory House, and also on our website, vtfwc.org. Yes? Okay, so we're getting it out there. You guys do your part, too, and share it with everybody you know. Amen?
Amen.
And on the front, as always, we have the Parsha, which you can study during the week, which I don't usually mention, but God said, don't forget. So don't forget, amen? Amen here. Amen. All right, so everybody have a blessed week, and share that GoFundMe link.
Who's going to invite somebody to church next week? You know, who's going to invite somebody to church next week?
I already have two coming.
You have two coming, Barbara? All right. So I have a special gift for whoever brings the most people to church next week. Can you hear me? But I only have one. I only have one special gift. So whoever brings the most people to church next week will receive a special gift. Good to see you. Okay, Sister Barbara, you want to come on the invitation?
The crab feed is wonderful. It's one of the best crab feeds, and it's not just because it's ours, but my niece gave me a wonderful crab person. They're in Stockton, and we get spaghetti, it's tri-tip, it's crab feed, it's salad, rolls. It's a wonderful crab feed, Neola. Really, you won't be sorry you came. And most of them, what'd you say, I'm sorry?
Plus the fellowship.
And we usually celebrate Pastor's birthday kind of on that day because it's right around his birthday. I knew that. So, this is offering time. And I'm so excited to see, and I'm sorry I forgot your names, Juanita's daughter and niece, right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, your names again?
Ariel.
Deanna.
Ariel and Deanna. Very good to see you again. We saw you last week, and I'm so glad you're back. Crafty, maybe we can even get the flopper if it'll fit on the bulletin, maybe next. Okay, she does wonders for the bulletin, so I know she'll be able to do it because she does. She's a miracle worker on the bulletin. I also wanted to, there was something else I wanted to mention, and I have forgotten what it is. I know what it is. The Lord gave us 2 extra checks in the mail this week.
Amen.
And you know, I don't know about you, but it's pretty exciting when that happens.
Amen.
Yes. And that always means that I can give more to Him.
Amen.
You know, I wanted to know, do any of you have something that the Lord has put on your heart that He's given you? Maybe He's blessed you in some way in the offering, or a miracle at home. If there is, raise your hand and I'll come down and tell you and let you share what the Lord has done for you. You know, I've been waiting for Juanita because, you know, the Lord is so faithful to you. You know, you just don't know because everyone doesn't share, but I'm telling you, God is faithful to bless those that give.
Well, you know, my husband had got, you know, he hasn't been working since October, but the Lord has, we were kind of struggling a little bit, and I felt bad because I really couldn't give like I wanted to give, but the Lord has really blessed us, so I'm able to give more, you know. He blessed us to where we can pay our bills like 2 or 3 months in advance, so that way we have more money to bless, you know, the church and stuff, so I thank God for that.
Amen.
Yes, bless you, Lord. You know, He does bless you. I mean, over and above what you can even think or imagine. I wish some of you would only know, and I know most of you, you know, we're really blessed because, you know, they say that 20 or 30% of the people give in their tithes and offering in the church, and I'm telling you, there's a lot more than that in this church. It's more like 80 to 90%, and that's unheard of. God is so good, and He blesses. He blesses. You know, it isn't that I didn't have something to share with you today, but I wanted to give you an opportunity to share because the Lord honors and blesses, you know, those that honor Him and are not ashamed of Him. He is always faithful. Yes, Mom.
You know, I have to tell you, there's one person here that they have
I always know when their tithes is in the offering because it's in a little bitty envelope. Itty bitty. And I go, oh my goodness. You know, we watch Let's Make a Deal sometimes in the morning when Mom and I are drinking coffee and just kind of waking up. And they have a little box that says, itty witty, teeny weeny box. And I just love it. I'm sorry, but God is so good. And God loves humor. God is not a, he's not a droopy God. He's an exciting God. And I love him, and I praise him. And if you can stand this morning, oh, you know, I know what it was I wanted to say to you. If you don't see some people give, you know, it isn't that they don't give. My mom reminded me, some people give by mail, through their computers, through our little keypad that we have. You know, God knows. You know, don't judge somebody just because you don't see them get up and give offering. You don't know what their heart is, and you don't know when they've given or what they've said and how they've given it. So don't assume that people are not giving because they are. Let's stand and pray and ask the Lord to just bless each and every one of us, the giver and the non-giver. Father, we know that you're not a prospective person, that you love every one of us, and you are faithful and just to us. And Lord, I just thank you that you don't just give in finance, that you help us. Somebody said this morning that their family's never been sick. You know, the Lord's faithful in every way, in our health, in our finance, in just protecting us from harm. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for being so faithful. We thank you so much that you have allowed us and that our families that have given us, they've taught us how to give. And Lord, I just thank you for in advance how you've blessed each and every one of us. And we thank you right now in Jesus' name. I want to also thank you for praying for my husband, Ray, because he's doing pretty good. I'm hoping that he'll be able to be here next week. If not next week, for sure the week after.
Amen.
Thank you. Okay. Amen.
Give it all to Jesus. Give it all to Jesus. Give it all to Jesus.
Tough love with Torah. Just because the death penalty cannot be enforced today does not mean the law is off the books. Each one of these sins carries the same grievous weight. In God's book, it's just as grievous a sin to curse one's parents or to strike them as it is to murder someone. For Moses said, honor your father and your mother, and he who speaks evil of father or mother is to be put to death. That's Mark 7 and 10. You know, in the commandments, it's the first commandment to honor your parents. It's the first commandment with a promise that you'll have a long life. Praise God. I think you are that one, Pastor. The Torah says that murderers, kidnappers, and insolent children are to be put to death. He who strikes his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. Exodus 21:15. You know, actually, there aren't any real recordings of anybody having to ever do that. But just knowing that that was the law. And you know, when we honor our Heavenly Father, and we honor His Son, and we honor our parents, God rewards us. But, you know, either we accept Jesus, or we don't have life. So He tells us to choose life. We want to choose to do what God says in His Word, so that we have life with Him forever. I think that's the summation of the death penalty there. There is no indication that a parent was killed or even badly hurt in altercation. I'm sorry, I'm having trouble seeing this. It's a light on light. The mere act of hitting one's father or mother is enough imprudence that God deems it as bad as murder. It's just that it's on the light background. My eyes are not just. This shows us how God's values are sometimes different from ours. Of course, we would never advocate striking one's father or mother, but neither would we feel comfortable putting someone to death for doing so. Family counseling? Yes. Anger management classes? Sure, death by stoning? Probably not. God sees it differently when He says, honor your father and your mother. Exodus 20:12, He means it. You know, my husband used to say that when the Bible says, honor your father and your mother, He says, and when your life honors them, your parents are proud, and that gives them a sense of satisfaction for having had you and raised you according to God's word. So it's always rewarding to be obedient, not only to the Lord, but to our parents. Similarly, Exodus 21:17 says, he who curses his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. What does it mean to curse one's parents? According to traditional Judaism, the passage is not speaking of simply abusive language. It's speaking of a real curse, like witchcraft, huh? If a son or daughter uses the holy name of the Lord to utter and intentionally curse against one of their parents, that son or daughter is worthy of death. Without a sovereign Torah, court-wielding civil authority, the death penalty no longer applies. No one has been stoned for Torah law in almost 2,000 years. The extreme punishment for striking or cursing one's parent is teaching the importance that biblical religion places on the integrity and decency of the family. Rebellion, violence, and insolence against one's parents, whether physical or verbal, is as much a threat to the fabric of society as murder and kidnapping. In today's world, society teaches children, particularly teenagers, to disrespect their parents. It is not normal to to hear teenagers speak to their parents with impertinent and insolent words. It is embarrassing to be around a family where the children are out of order. You know, a while back, the Lord was dealing with me on the order of things. Everything God did, he had an order to. When he had them prepare the tabernacle in the wilderness, he had the skins on the outside for the protection. And you know that the tabernacle in the wilderness represented parts of the body, because God wants to tabernacle within us. And how can he tabernacle within us if we don't obey the things that he has taught us to live by? His word is an instruction book for joyous and perfect living. And if we follow that, he gives us his blessings that we can't even contain if we're obedient, because obedience is better than even sacrifice. Children who disrespectfully speak back to their parents are a public disgrace to their family. As a society, we have lost the biblical value of honoring our fathers and mothers. The Apostle Paul warned that in the last days, the spirit of rebelliousness would be unleashed upon the world. He said that men would be arrogant, revelers, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, unloving, irreconcilable. 2 Timothy 3:2-3. He advised us to avoid such men as these in 2 Timothy 3:5. Paul's recommendation is good child rearing advice. If you don't want your child to grow up to be disrespectful and mouthy towards you, don't have them socialize with other children who are disrespectful to their parents. It's a serious matter. Yes, the Bible says that bad companions corrupt good manners. So if we teach our children to live after the ways of God, it would be good to separate them from others, because there are a lot of wolves in sheep's clothing that would lead them astray. They would come seeking their friendship, and they would really not have their best interest at heart. So be blessed today by the Torah. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Faith will move mountains. Faith will open the fountains. Faith will make you to succeed. Faith will supply your every need. Where is your faith? In God. See the promise. Faith will move mountains. Faith will open the fountains. Faith will make you to not help you, make you. We're gonna change it. Make you to. Faith will make you to succeed. Faith shall supply your every need. And where is your faith? In God. One more time. Faith will move mountains. Faith will open the fountains. Faith will make you to succeed. Faith shall supply your every need. Where is your faith? In God. Amen. Faith. Faith. Faith is the currency in God's kingdom. Amen. Faith is the currency in God's kingdom. Hope make not of shame, but faith moves mountains. Amen. Faith takes. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today. I ask that your anointing will be upon me to deliver your word, and that your people will receive exactly what you have for them today. We give you all the praise and the glory. Lord, we give you all the honor, Lord. And we thank you in the name of Yeshua, Jesus our Savior, soon coming King, and all God's people said. Amen. Hallelujah. Reading from the Tree of Life version of the Bible, it's perfectly okay if you would like to study this at home in the King James. But I prefer this Tree of Life. It's a newer translation that has been done primarily by Jewish scholars that are believers in Jesus as the Messiah. And so they have just gone back to the original text and interpreted the way through a traditional perspective of the children of God. You know? Let us look at Matthew chapter 9, verses 18 to 38. Just as he was saying these things, who is he? Jesus, yeah, Yeshua, okay, or Jesus. Just as he was saying these things to them, a synagogue leader came and began to bow before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come lay your hand on her and she will live." Anybody know who that was? What was his name? Jireh. He was a leader in the synagogue, and he knew that Yeshua, that Jesus was and is the Messiah. He knew all he had to do was say the word and she would be healed. Amen? But Yeshua is going to tell him something very important here. "My daughter has just died, but come lay your hand on her head and she will live." And Yeshua got up and began to follow him with his disciples. Just then a woman, losing blood for 12 years, came from behind and touched the tzitzit of his garment. Do you know what the tzitzit are? Do you know what they are? We know it as the hem, you know, but it's the tzitzit. Pastor Johnny, go get one of the prayer shawls in the office, please. You know, the traditional garments that the Jewish people would wear, especially the men would wear under, well, only the men, excuse me, would wear under their clothing were a prayer shawl, prayer garment. They were covered in prayer. They were covered, it was symbolized, they were covered in the protection of the Word of God, the protection of the one God who was able to save and protect them. You know? Now, this woman knew that the tzitzit, the knots, they were knots that are tied on the bottom of the prayer shawl. Okay. Now today we only use a shawl as a representation of this. Pastor Johnny, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So today here's a prayer shawl. And they just wrap it around their shoulders or in their they put it on top of them, for instance, like this. Mm-hmm. to represent the ancient prayer garments that men wore underneath their clothes. Some of the Orthodox wear them under their clothes still, but men don't wear robes. Like men used to wear robes, you know, as common dress. Now we wear pants. And so, but back in the time of Jesus, it was customary for men to wear robes, and they would have a prayer shawl or a prayer garment underneath their main robe, and the tzitzit, these, see these knots right here? They're in blue and white. Would hang out underneath the bottom of the robe. And it was an ever reminder that God's word, say God's word, was upon them. See these knots? You see these knots? A traditional tzitzit, the traditional knots, or the hem, hanging out from under the robe, would have these knots on there. And they are tied in a way. See how they're tied, these knots, to where there would be 613 different knots or ties. And do you know why there were 613 knots or ties?
For the commandments.
Because that is how many commandments are found in the Torah. If you look at the first five books of the Bible given to us by God through Moses, you have, or we call it the Pentateuch sometimes, the Jewish people would call it, refer to it as the Torah. There were 613 commandments given. Why is this important to know? Because it represents the Word of God. The tzitzit represents the Word of God. And this woman crawling through the crowd, she understood who the Word was. It, and forever shall be. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Amen? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word is God. Amen. He is God. Amen. Hallelujah. So, this woman knew that if she could even touch the tzitzit of his garment, then she would be touching him. Because the tzitzit of his garment represented who he was and is. That he is the living Word of God. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was who he the Word was with God. The Word is God. Go to John 1:1 real quick. Let's see how it reads in this translation. I'm filling it for a loop here. Thank you, Kevin, for traveling with me here. We know that Yeshua was born during the Feast of Tabernacles. What do we call him at Christmas time? What do we sing in this song? Emmanuel, Emmanuel, his name is called Emmanuel. God with us, revealed in us, his name is called Emmanuel. You see, he came, he lived, and he dwelt among us. He is the God of creation. Jesus, it says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Amen? In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Who is the Word? Jesus. Who is the Torah? Jesus. He is the living Torah that came and dwelt among us. You understand? So the woman falling through the crowd, go back to our text, she realized that Christ was and is the Word. That Christ was and is the Messiah. And she knew that if she could even touch the representation of Messiah, that she would be healed. Just then, a woman losing blood for 12 years came from behind and touched the tzitzit of his garment. For she kept saying to herself, if only I touch his garment, I will be healed. But then Yeshua turned and saw her thinking, "Take heart, daughter," he said, "your faith has made you well." That very hour, the woman was healed. When Yeshua came into the synagogue leader's house and saw the flute players and a noisy crowd wailing, he said, "Go away, for the girl isn't dead, but she is sleeping." And they began jeering at him. But when the crowd had been cleared out, he went and he took her hand, and the girl got up. And the news of this spread all around that region. And Yeshua went on from there. Two blind men followed him, crying out, "Ben David, have mercy on us." When he went into the house, the blind men came to him. And Yeshua said to them, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" "Yes, Master," they said to him. Then he touched their eyes, saying, "According to your faith, let it be done for you." And their eyes were opened, and Yeshua warned them sternly, "See that no one knows." But they went out and spread the news about him all around that region. As they were going out, a mute man, led by a demon, was brought to him. After the demon was driven out, the mute man started speaking. The crowds were astounded, saying, "Never has anything like this been seen in Israel." But the Pharisees were saying, "By the prince of demons, he drives out demons." Now Yeshua, going around all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every kind of disease and sickness, when he saw the crowds, he felt compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Therefore, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he may send out workers into his harvest field." Hallelujah. So what do we see in this passage of scripture? We see evidence of God's healing power through the hand of Yeshua because of what? Faith. We see evidence of the dead even being returned to life because of what?
Faith.
We see evidence of demons being cast out of men because of what?
Faith.
We see evidence of the blind having their eyes opened because of what?
Faith.
And because this news spread in the entire region, wherever Yeshua went, people were expecting what? A miracle. And where he went in the regions, they received what?
A miracle.
A miracle. Why? Because they had faith. If we read in another portion of the scripture, during the same thing I was reading for you today, you see that Yeshua, he turns to Jairus and he says, "Do not fear, only believe."
Amen.
You see, with the woman came crawling through the crowd. Now, Yeshua knew what was going to happen. Remember, he is the beginning of the end, and only he comes in the fullness of the volume of the book.
Amen. Amen.
And at the very moment that Jairus was telling him that his daughter had died, Yeshua knew this woman was coming through the crowd. And when he feels her about to touch him, he turns to Jairus and he says, "Do not fear, only believe."
Amen.
He was saying, don't think that because this isn't happening in the time you think it's going to happen, that it will not happen.
Amen.
Keep your faith.
Amen.
Have you ever been believing God for a miracle in your life? And you expected that miracle to happen at a certain time or a certain place. But that miracle did not happen when you thought it was going to happen. But guess what? You continue to stand firm in your faith, believing. And what happened? God answered prayer. God fulfilled his word like he always does time and time again. God's time is not our time.
You've heard little sayings before. What am I hear all the time? It says, God's delay is not a denial.
Amen.
Just because you have time and you think something needs to be done does not mean that God has denied your petition when it doesn't come to pass in the time frame you expected.
Amen.
God's delays are not denials. But He knows the end from the beginning. He alone comes in the fullness of the volume of the book. He alone knows what is best for you and what is best for me. And more importantly, what is best for the kingdom of God as a whole. He knows what we do not know. He is able to perform every promise in His word. He says that we must only believe. 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 Believe that His word is true. Believe He is able to keep His word. Believe He has brought life, a new life to you through the resurrection power of His Spirit and the birth of your spirit into the kingdom of God as you were born again.
All right.
Believe it. Believe that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe should not perish but should have everlasting life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through Him the world might be saved. The scripture goes on to tell us in the next verse that those in the world were condemned already. They didn't need Yeshua to come to condemn them. They needed Him to come and save them. We read again in scripture time and time again where Jesus was among the non-religious people. Why? Because He was bringing light into the darkness. At one particular time, He was down in an area of town that was known for debauchery and non-religious activity. That's a nice way to say it. It was such a bad part of town that His mother and His brothers wouldn't even go there because they didn't want their reputation to be tainted. And they went after Yeshua and they stood outside and they sent people in and they said to Him, "Your mother and your brothers want you." And Yeshua looked around and He said, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" Those that do the will of the Father are my mother and my brothers. He also said, the well have no need for a physician, but the sick do. So let's not get so religious and self-righteous that we forget to go into the highways and into the byways and to where people need to know about the saving power of the blood of Yeshua. We read in the Torah today that the penalty for striking your parent was what?
Death.
What are the wages of sin?
Death.
Who paid the consequence for our sin? Jesus Christ our Lord. He paid that price. He paid that penalty. That is why we no longer have to stone our children when they strike our parents.
That's right.
Not only did He pay the price for that penalty, the penalty for that sin, but He paid the penalty for all sin for all time. You see, when Jesus taught His disciples, He said, if you're guilty of breaking one of the commandments,
you're guilty of breaking them all. Yep.
So if you sin even once in your life, which all of us do, because the Word of God says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, then you are guilty of death. Oh, but for the grace. We sing about His amazing grace because of what Jesus did for us on Calvary. We no longer have to pay the penalty for our sin.
Amen.
He already did.
Yes, He did.
But we must have faith to believe, even to be born again. And then we must have faith to believe that every promise in that word is true. And if we come to him, the word of God says not to ask anything of him without faith.
Amen.
Believe that he will provide that answer.
Amen.
So I'm here to tell you today to get a hold of the faith that was placed within you. Get a hold of it. The Apostle Paul said to Timothy to stir up the gift. So faith is a gift. The gift of faith that was placed in you by the laying on of hands.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. To stir up the gift of faith that was placed within you by the laying on of hands.
Amen.
So there are times when you need to stir up that gift. You need to remind yourself that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that what he says he will do, he will do. In fact, it says we are seated, Ephesians chapter 2, we are seated in heavenly places with him as kings and priests.
Right.
He's already fulfilled it.
Yes.
You just have to believe and realize. Now, I'm not to get confused. I'm not wanting you to get confused with the word of faith.
All right.
The name it, claim it, blab it, grab it. You see, God is sovereign.
Right.
We don't run around and make up things that we want from our own selfish fleshly desires and command God to give it to us. It doesn't work
right
now.
But
the Spirit of God that rose Christ from the dead dwells in you.
Amen.
And if that same Spirit that rose Christ from the dead dwells in you, it will either quicken your mortal body when it's alive to join him in the air, or it will raise you up from the grave to join him in the air.
Amen.
Just like it raised Christ.
But
that same Spirit of the holy, righteous God that dwells within you will guide you.
Amen.
And it will tell you the things that God has for you.
Amen.
And then you, in faith, will believe them.
Yes.
And receive them and come to him in faith, asking for those very things he has promised you both personally and through his word.
Amen.
Faith.
Amen.
Faith.
Yeah.
Faith.
Faith. Faith.
Faith is the currency in God's kingdom.
Amen.
Remember that. Faith is the currency in God's kingdom.
Amen.
When you give a tithe or an offering, let's take it a step of faith, because you're saying you are believing God to meet your needs above and over what is normal. And you're going to, now, we've already received our tithe and offering. I'm not trying to get a bigger offering today. I'm just telling you, that is a step of faith. When you go down, you put your tithe into the church offering, where it's good ground. The Bible says that already belonged to God, and you are affirming God's word to be true by saying, okay, this belongs to God, it's not even mine, so I'm giving it to him.
Right.
And that's going to keep the canker word and the devourer coming to my finances, because this is God's, and I'm not going to rob from God. I'm going to give the tithe. And when you give your offering, that is saying, this comes from my heart. And I trust that anything I give to God, he's going to give back to me. In fact, his word says, when I give to the poor, I lend to the Lord. When I give a particular type of an offering unto his household, a love offering, a first fruits offering, the different offerings we find in the scripture. When I give this offering to the Lord, when I sow a seed,
He is going to return it to me, some 30, some 60, some 100 fold.
All right.
So giving is an act of faith. Coming to the altar for prayer and believing is an act of faith. Looking into the Word of God, where it has a promise for your life, and claiming that promise as though speaking those things as if they are when they are not.
Right.
You understand? You speak those things that are even though they are not. So you proclaim, you pronounce, you declare the promises you find in the Scripture. You pronounce, you declare, and you proclaim the promises His Spirit speaks to your heart. And you come to Him in faith, believing that He is going to bring those things to pass. And He will every single time. Let's stand our feet. How many of you need the measure of your faith increased? How many of you need, that was a trick question. I gotta come down to the altar. Pastor Dan? Hallelujah. I know you operate in this area. Come on down to the altar. Come on down. You raise your hand. You need faith. Increase the amount of faith. Increase the measure of faith in your life. I'm first in line, Pastor Dan. I need more faith too. Alright, hallelujah. And we're gonna do like the Apostle Paul said, we're going to have faith put into us by the laying on of hands. Amen. We're going to have Pastor Johnny come as well. And after we are anointed, we're going to have Pastor Johnny also. Hallelujah. 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 So we're going to have Pastor Dan and Pastor Johnny both anoint us with oil. And he's going to pray over us as he comes down the line. And he can pray however the Holy Spirit leads him to pray, and I'm going to be first.
God, the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead and dwells in you, that is the resurrection that's in you already. The resurrection is in you already, but it's waiting for a certain sound. The sound of God. When that sound comes, the dead Christ arise. But you, who are alive, already have the resurrection power in you. Now, to reveal or unveil it, that's up to you. You can open the curtain or keep it closed. Well, we're going to pray this morning here because God's opened up that curtain. So it's revealed. Amen. So the glory that's within the Holy of Holies is being revealed to this world. And the light is not only just for you, but it's for all. So we pray. I pray for that what's in you already. Amen. I'm not putting nothing in you. I'm going to reveal what's already there. That should be there already.
Awaken the watching. In the name of Jesus. Awaken them. Let her speak into it.
Let his holy
I anticipate the inevitable, supernatural. In the God, I expect a miracle. I expect a miracle. I expect a miracle. The Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord grant you his shalom. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. That we should be called the sons of God. That we should be called the sons of God. And we are. Go with God and be blessed.